Those of you that have ever heard me teach, for the last 42 years I've been preaching. And I began to discover that I was sharing things that I believe that God was saying. If you read the Bible, you'll find out in Jeremiah 33:3, God says, call unto me, and I will answer. And I'll tell you great and mighty things which you know not. If you look at John 10:27, he says, my sheep hear my voice, and another's voice they will not follow. And so God speaks to each and every one of us. He speaks to all of his sons and daughters. And through the years, as I've prayed and I've sought God and I've shared things that I believe that God was giving me to share with each and every one of you, anybody that would listen to me, I've tried to share what God's word says. Back in November when Kate got married, I stepped off of the platform. I stepped off out at Christian Missions, and I stepped down, and I told y'all I was going to stop screaming and hollering. That God said it was time to enter into a new season. And we're entered into a new season in 2020. 2020 means perfect vision. 2020 is perfect hindsight. In the Hebrew calendar, 2020 was 5780. 5780, if you look at the numbers, 5 means God's grace, 7 means the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, and 8 means new beginnings, and 80 means the voice of God. And so I truly believe that the voice of God began to be poured out to his sons and daughters like never before in 2020. And he began to speak to us. And as you listen to those words that were just presented in that group of different things that have been said, through the years, y'all have heard me say a lot of things. And I've had many of you tell me that you thought I was crazy 25 years ago, but now you begin to see some of the things that I've been speaking. It's not because I am anything. It's because as a little boy, I read the Bible. And when I read the Bible, he said, from the days of John the Baptist till the day, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force. He has a ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. You go to the book of Revelation, from chapter 1, chapter 2, you'll see 7 times that he writes letters to the church. In each one of the letters to the church, he ends it with, he is near to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. I cried out and I said, God, I want to have that ear to hear. And so as God began to call me and I began to listen to what he was saying and what he was speaking, God speaks to his Holy Spirit, to his church, to his sons and daughters. And he told us that we do not need to neglect his word as he speaks to us, because he's going to shake everything that can be shaken. The next 10 years, beginning with 2020, I believe is the most pivotal time in the history of the United States of America. I believe it's the most pivotal time in the church of the living God. I believe that God is pouring his Spirit out upon his sons and daughters like never before. It began at Pentecost, as you heard. The word that I gave you for 2022 is reality. And if we're going to speak of reality, if we're going to walk in reality, then we've got to get real with one another. And we've got to speak truth with one another. March the 26th of 2021, 2 new Dead Sea Scrolls were found. They've been hidden for thousands of years. And they found the Dead Sea Scrolls years ago, and they brought them out. And as they found the Dead Sea Scrolls, it began to prove what the Bible teaches and what the Bible says. And as you begin to read and you begin to study and you find out that there's 2 new Dead Sea Scrolls, because Sadie and I believe in Jeremiah 33:3, calling me and I will answer, and I'll tell you great and mighty things which you not know. When those scrolls were found, we ran to find out what Zechariah 8:16-17 said, because we needed to know what is God saying today. And those words that were written in Zechariah 8:16-17, they could read in the cave, out in the Qumran caves, and they could read them in the original text. And as they read those, to speak to you in country terms what God was saying, he said, church, I'm tired of you lying to one another. Church, I want you to speak truth, justice, and peace in your gates. Your gates speak of your arena of influence. Everywhere you step your foot. The original church of the living God was a spiritual church. We have turned it into an institutional church. We've turned it into a structural church. The tornado that came through here a few weeks ago, it hit the physical building of Christian Missions. But we don't attend church because we is the church. It's a message I've been preaching. So ever since I began here in Jacksboro, Sadie and I started 27 years ago. And as you look at those words of the Zechariah scroll and the book of Nahum scroll, the book of Zechariah, after he says, speak truth, justice, and peace in your gates, he says, by the way, stop lying to one another, because I hate lying. I believe that we have been lied to, y'all. I believe that every day of our life, if you turn on any news feed, you're going to get lied to. That's why I don't turn on news feeds. I go to the main source, and I ask him what I need to know. My sons and daughters, he says, you've got to learn to hear my voice, because my sheep will follow no other voice. If you have received Jesus Christ, then the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead dwells within you. You have the same Spirit that lives within me. And so therefore you can hear God's voice. Maybe you haven't been taught, maybe you haven't learned. I began to practice hearing God's voice as a child. And so those things that you've heard for many, many years, the words that God has spoken, each and every one of you have heard those things. And you can't deny that God was speaking to us. The day before the tornado hit, the message that I had to stand up and preach to you, but I was not able to speak to you because I couldn't breathe. But the message was to put on the whole armor of God, knowing that evil days are here. And in the evil day, you've got to stand, therefore putting on the whole armor of God. And so God even had us prepared for the thing that took place. And as we look at all that God is saying, then you've got to rediscover the Word of God. I've been sharing with you for the last 6 weeks on the rediscovering the peace of God. Jesus said, my peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world has, but we should live in peace. We should walk in peace. We should be peace, and we should exemplify that peace, because God sends a peace that surpasses all understanding. We're to walk in God's love, and we're to rediscover God's love, that He understands us, everything about us. The hairs of our head are numbered, and so therefore He knows it all, and He still loves us unconditionally. There's nothing that we can do that can separate us from God and His love. He said not even the gates of hell himself can separate us. And so we've got to rediscover that love of God. We've got to rediscover the goodness of God. The goodness of God leads a person, a man, a woman to repentance. It's not hellfire and brimstone. It's not fear that's going to lead you to repentance. It's the goodness of God, that understanding that He knows everything about you. He knows everything you've done, everything you've thought, everything you've said. But He still sent Jesus to die for you. And He says, did I send Him? And He died and He rose again. And now I send the Spirit. And the Spirit's going to come in and dwell every believer so that you can walk like Jesus walked. So you can talk like Jesus talked. And so as we rediscover these things of God and we rediscover His goodness. Last week I shared with you we're to rediscover the righteousness of God. Righteousness means right standing. In right standing with God. Righteousness. Our righteousness, the Bible speaks, is as filthy rags. There is none good. Jesus is our righteousness. Because Jesus was tempted in every area, yet He knew no sin. And so when we receive Jesus, we become the righteousness of God in and through Christ Jesus. So when God looks at each and every one of us, He sees Jesus in us. And so therefore, we walk in righteousness. We walk in right standing with God. Friday night, I was adamant that Christian Missions would celebrate the Passover. And so today, I want to talk to you about rediscovering the Passover of God. Because it is God's Passover. It's not man's Passover. It was God's Passover. And if you got your Bibles this morning, we're going to turn to Exodus chapter 12. And as we turn to Exodus chapter 12, throw me those glasses there, please, Sadie. Thank you. As we look at Exodus chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. Used to, I had a monitor in front of me and I could stand and read it. Now it's behind me and I can't turn around there and put my back to y'all. So I've got to be able to see it myself. So if we look at Exodus chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. Now the Lord spoke to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, saying, "This month shall be your beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you. Speak to all the congregation of Israel, saying, on the 10th of the month, every man shall take for himself a lamb according to the house of his father, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next to his house take it according to the number of the persons, according to each man's need. You shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, without spot." This is a part of what God is saying to the church today. He is coming back for a pure bride without spot or blemish. And so he told them to sacrifice that lamb that without blemish. A male of the first year, you may take it from the sheep or from the goats. Now you shall keep it until the 14th day of the same month. Then the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill it at twilight. And they shall take some of the blood and put it on two doorposts and on the lintel of the houses where they eat it. Then they shall eat the flesh on the night, roasted in fire with unleavened bread and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Do not eat it raw nor boil it with all water, but roasted in fire, its head with it, its legs and its entrails. You shall let none of it remain until morning. What remains of it until morning you shall burn with fire. And thus you shall eat it with a belt on your waist, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. So you shall eat it in haste. It is, who does this say it is? It's the Lord's Passover. So today what I want to talk to you about is the Lord's Passover. Rediscovering. It's His. "For I will pass through the land of Egypt on that night and will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am the Lord." If you read Romans chapter 5 in verse 1, he said, "We have been justified by grace. We have been saved from the wrath of God, from the judgment of God." The judgment of God will come upon this earth and will come upon everyone who has not received Christ as Savior. "Now the blood shall be a sign for you on the house where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be on you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. So this day shall be to you a memorial, and you shall keep it as a feast in the Lord throughout your generation. You shall keep it as a feast by an everlasting ordinance." One of the words I gave you this year, God is reestablishing His feast. Verse 15, 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the fifth day you shall remove leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from the day, first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day, why is he removing the leaven? Because a little leaven leavens the whole lump. We cannot mix the things of the world with the church. Complacency, compromise, and commitment, the lack thereof, are in the world, they have infiltrated the church. And so there is a complacency about following God, about obeying God's word. And so there is a lack of commitment. And there is a compromise. We are mixing things of the world with the things of God, and we think that God is pleased with it. Thank you very much. 7 days you shall eat unleavened bread. On the first day you shall remove leaven from your houses. For whoever eats leavened bread from that first day until the seventh day, that person shall be cut off from Israel. On the first day there shall be a holy convocation, and on the seventh day there shall be a holy convocation for you. No manner of work shall be done on them, but that which everyone must eat, that only must be prepared by you. So you shall observe the feast of unleavened bread. For on this same day I will have brought your armies out of the land of Egypt. Therefore you shall observe this day throughout your generations as an everlasting ordinance." How long is everlasting? "In the first month, on the 14th day of the month at evening, you shall eat unleavened bread until the 21st day of the month at evening. For 7 days no leaven shall be found in your houses, since whoever eats what is leaven, that same person shall be cut off from the congregation of Israel.
whether he is a stranger or a native of the land. You shall eat nothing leavened. In all your dwellings you shall eat unleavened bread. This is a picture of the church today, not mixing the unholy with the holy. Then Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said to them, pick out and take lambs for yourself according to your families, and kill the Passover lamb. And you shall take a bunch of hyssop, do it in blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two doorposts, the lintel and the two doorposts with it, the blood that is in the basin, and none of you shall go out of the door of his house until morning. For the Lord will pass through to strike the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood on the lintel and on the two doorposts, the Lord will pass over the door and not allow the destroyer to come into your houses and strike you. And you shall observe this thing as an ordinance to you and your sons, however long.
Forever.
Is it as long as we want to? He says forever. I think we're still in ever, don't you? It will come to pass when you come to the land which the Lord will give you, just as he promised, that you shall keep this service. And it shall be when your children say to you, what do you mean by this service? Then you shall say, it is the Passover sacrifice of the Lord. Whose sacrifice is it? Whose Passover is it? It's the Lord's. Sacrifice of the Lord who passed over the house of the children of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians and delivered our households. So the people bowed their heads and worshiped. Then the children of Israel went away and did so just as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron. So they did. Well, that's Old Testament. We're under the New Covenant. We're under the New Testament. We're under Jesus. We follow what Jesus said. We follow what Jesus does. Does? Did. Turn to Matthew chapter 26. I'm getting hot up here. I'm getting warmed up. How about y'all? Okay. In Matthew chapter 26, beginning with verse 17. Now, on the first day of the feast of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus, saying to him, where do you want us to prepare for you to eat the Passover? And he said, go into the city to a certain man and say to him, the teacher says, my time is at hand. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples. So the disciples did as Jesus has directed them, and they prepared the Passover. When evening had come, he sat down with the 12. Now as they were eating, he said, assuredly I say to you, one of you will betray me. And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and said each of them, began to say to him, Lord, is it I? He answered and said, he who dipped his hand with me in the dish will betray me. The Son of Man indeed goes just as it is written for him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, who was betraying him, answered and said, Rabbi, it is I. He said to him, you have said it. And as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup and gave thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. But I say to you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. And when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. The study Bible that I use, in here it says, God sovereignly inaugurates the new covenant. The blood Jesus used this occasion of the Passover meal to inaugurate the new covenant. The symbolism of the Passover meal under the old covenant was about to be fully satisfied through Christ's crucifixion. No longer did they have to kill a lamb and offer the blood for that blood atoning sacrifice. They no longer had to put the blood over their doorpost to represent the death angel had to pass over. So Christ's crucifixion fully satisfied that. In this historic moment, Jesus transformed the meaning of the elements of the Passover meal into the new covenant thought. The bread now represented his body, which would be given, and the cup, his blood, which would be shed for the forgiveness of sins. The holy requirements of God under the old covenant were about to be forever satisfied. A new and living way into the presence and the promise of provision of God was being prepared through Christ. the Lamb of God. A new and eternal bond was being established by the blood of Jesus Christ. God was sovereignly inaugurating the new and ultimate covenant. We have been given that new covenant. We operate under that new covenant. And as I begin to go through all of these things and I look at all of these things, when the church began, the church was a spiritual church. And then all of a sudden, we begin to get more. What would be the word? We're no longer heathens. What are we? What's the word? Well, what I'm trying to think about is, how about politically correct? We become more woke. Wokeism begins to come about. And so we begin to do things because we know better than what the Word of God says. Without the shedding of blood, there was no remission of sins. And so God built a spiritual house. In 1 Peter 2:5, he tells us that we are living stones, that we are being built together as a spiritual house, a house in the Spirit, not made with hands. God says, no longer do I inhabit that place that's called the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of Covenant is, where no one could enter but once a year the high priest. From now on, I'm going to inhabit mankind. And they were going to be a spiritual house. But we began to know so much that we began to build great buildings. And we began to build great cathedrals. And they were so elaborate and so beautiful. And we began to say, this is where God dwells. Well, that goes back to the Old Testament. But we began to do it and say, you got to come to these great massive buildings. This is a great building. I'm thankful we have it. But Jesus didn't die for this building. He died for each and every one of you. He died for you. And he rose again, that you might walk like he walks, talk like he talks. You might go into all the world. You might go out in the marketplace, everywhere you go. Out of this room, there's not many of us that stand in podiums and scream and holler at the people. I'm the one that gets that privilege here, because it is a privilege and an honor to tell you what God's Word says. And as you begin to read throughout your Bible and you begin to see what God's Word says, you begin to study what's taken place in church history. I've read about all the great awakenings. I've read about the Reformation that took place. And I truly saw in the Reformation, that's one of the things that changed my life, the priesthood of the believer. No longer did they have to go in to have a priest ask for forgiveness of sins. No longer did we have to do all these rituals and follow all these rules, regulations to receive the forgiveness of our sin. All we had to do was run to Daddy and say, Father, I blew it. I blew it, Daddy. And he said, go and sin no more, my son. All of your sins are under the blood of Jesus. But we began to make it about a structural. We began to make it about an institutional church that people attended. In the United States of America, we begin to draw away from the world and say, separate yourself from the world. Yes, we're not to be about the world. We're not to let the world infiltrate us. We are not to let the leaven into us, because a little leaven leavens the whole lump. Read Galatians chapter 5, 9, or 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 12, and you'll see that a little leaven, if you put a little in there, it leavens the whole lump. So when we try to mix grace and law, we nullify grace. When we try to mix the world with the church, and we try to look like the church, we try to build programs, and we try to build podiums. We try to build it all about personalities and about performance. And we build it about smoke and mirrors instead of about the Spirit of the living God coming and speaking to each and every one of us. Then we have left original intent of why God formed and fashioned each and every one of us. This year the Word is reality, and we want to get real with one another. In John 4:23, he says, those who worship God must worship in spirit and in truth. And today is that day that we worship him in spirit and in truth. And God is searching for such to worship him in that spirit and in that truth. Just recently, there was another discovery that was let out in Israel. It was actually discovered back in 2019, but they took several years to try to figure out what it said. And they found it on Mount Ebal. And if you read the book of Joshua, you'll find out that Joshua sacrificed upon Mount Ebal. And Mount Ebal was the mountain that they presented curses before mankind. And they found a lead plate that was bent in half. And as they begin to study and read it, it says, "Cursed are you by Yahweh, God Almighty." And it says it 10 times. 10 means God's perfect order. God is putting His church back into perfect order. God is shaking everything that can be shaken, that where nothing that will remain except that that is of the kingdom. The message of the kingdom, Jesus said, that the kingdom is here, the kingdom is within you, the kingdom is to now. And this gospel of the kingdom is about us being a spiritual church. It's about us going into all the world and being sons and daughters of the Most High God. It is not about attending, but it's about going. But we have called people to come and hear Moses speak. And hear what Moses has to say. Back in the 4th century, the Church of the Living God was a spiritual church, and it was growing so fast and it was moving. And there was a man named Constantine in March of 321. Y'all want to know what day? Y'all want to know what day the tornado hit Jacksboro, Texas? 3/21 of 22. You want to know what time I got the first call that the tornado hit? 3/21 on 3/21. I can't make this stuff up, y'all. I ask you to please hear my heart today. Hear the heart of the Father. Satan could not control the church, so he joined the church. He joined the church. And in the 4th century, they created a pyramid scheme, the very first one. And they said, "We're going to put man at the top, and when man is at the top, if the man controls the rest of the body, then we've got him." The Protestants looked at it and said, "Man, we like that. Let's do it in every building. Let's set the man up on top, and then they control the body." You'll be known as my sons because you're led by my Spirit, is what the Bible says. Each and every one of you have to study to show yourselves approved of God. It's the glory of God to conceal a matter. It's the glory of kings, little k's, to search out a matter. It's up for each and every one of you. No matter what I share here, you've got to go and search it out. You've got to research it. You've got to find out for yourself. I've been telling y'all for several years. Anybody that has a smartphone, you can do a little Google search and say, "Where did Easter come from in the Christian church?" And you'll read more than you want to read. And you'll see things that you don't want to see. On 3/21, in March of 7th of 3/21, Constantine called a council of Nicaea. If you hear Sadie speak on anything that she puts on YouTube and the things that she speaks about in her prayer times, she'll talk about the wicked council of Nicaea, because it was about controlling the church. It was about making a one church a rule, a one church order, a one world order, if you would. And they said, Constantine hated the Jews, and he said, "We will not celebrate Passover with those people. We will not celebrate their Sabbath," which was Saturday. Today is Sunday. He said, "We'll worship on Sunday. We'll break it down. S-U-N-D-A-Y. Why do we call it Sunday? Because Baal is the sun god and we worship Baal. Let's call the most holy day of the year Easter. Why do we want to call it Easter? Because there's a pagan holiday that celebrates Esther, Ishtar, Astore, Astoreth, Astoreth, the pagan wife of Baal, the sex goddess, the fertility goddess. In the United States of America today, the statistics show that only 1% of the United States claim to be LGBTQXYZ. Only 3% of the U.S. claim to be transsexual. Move to the millennials. How many of y'all are millennials today in this room? In the millennials, do the survey and you'll find out that 1% goes to 27%. Go to the 3% and it turns to 17%. The Church of the Living God is losing a generation. Why? Let's speak the truth. Let's tell the truth. This morning, the first feed that hit my phone. Was it a mother dressed in the Easter bunny? Went to the elementary school and started handing out eggs to all the students that were leaving the elementary school. And they were filled with candy and condoms. In the public schools in the United States of America, they're having drag queen reading hour in the elementary schools. They are teaching elementary students LBGT, WXYZ. Why do I say WXYZ? Because there's an unlimited amount now. You can be anything you want to be. There is no absolute truth except of what God's Word says. Man, this is really good, Eugene. I'm glad I came today. They're handing out condoms in the elementary schools in the United States of America. Critical race theory is being taught in the elementary schools in the United States of America. Critical race theory teaches that all whites are racist and evil people. In the United States of America, in the public schools, the parents are being told they have no parental rights to tell their kid what they can be taught and what they can't be taught. They can teach them anything they want to teach. You want to wonder why the seven mountains are coming down? The mountain of education is being exposed. You know, all of that stuff, you know what happens up yonder, up there in north, New York City or somewhere. Well, guess where the Easter Bunny was at last Thursday? Austin, Texas. Oh, my God. That is exactly right. You want to know why I've told y'all since day one of starting this that we celebrate resurrection? Do you think maybe some of this stuff that is taking place is because the Church of the Living God took a pagan holiday called Esther, about the fertility god? You think maybe that's why all of this stuff is taking place in our public schools now? Because we in the United States of America, in the Church of the Living God, we have thought it's okay to mix the world with church services. Man, it's entertaining. What about the Spirit of God moving? What about be holy, for I am holy? Y'all, I've taught a message of grace for ever since I began. And we are saved by grace, not by works, lest any man should boast. But I'm here to tell you, God says there's a line drawn. And it's a hard line. And it's a separation between the righteous contenders and the religious pretenders. We have a choice. Are we going to want to know the truth? Jesus said it's the truth that you know that makes you free. Luke chapter 16 verse 15 says, you are those who justify yourselves before men, but God knows your hearts. For what is highly esteemed among men is an abomination in the sight of God. Churches in the United States of America that call themselves Christian churches or ordaining those same transsexuals, LBGT, WXY, and Z. It's okay. God loves everybody. Yeah, he does. He loves us so much that Jesus died. And he rose again. And he's coming again, but he says the heavens must retain him until the message of the kingdom goes into all the world. The gospel of the kingdom has to be preached. I was going to preach today, rediscovering the kingdom of God. But I spoke yesterday and day before. I spoke night before last. Sadie and I spoke in West Texas at a Passover event. And I was asked to tell about some of these things. And I shared, and there was a preacher sitting beside me on the panel, and his eyes got big, real big, and he leaned back and looked at me. And the next morning, we got up to speak again, and he said, "Man, this guy blowed up my theology. I had to go home and study last night." And he said, "Oh, my God, I didn't know. I didn't know. I've been telling y'all for several years to go and research. It's real simple today, man. I researched all of this stuff 35 years ago, back when I didn't have a computer. I researched it in real books, in things they call libraries. Today, you can search them out on your cell phone, and it don't take very long. And when you research it, you go, oh, my God, oh, my God, oh, my God, what do we do with this?" Well, on March the 26th of 2021, God said, "The line's drawn, no more. I want truth to be spoken from my podiums, from my pulpits. I want truth to be spoken in the marketplace. I want my church to return to being a spiritually led church that is led by the Spirit of the living God." And James chapter 4:17 says, "Him who knows to do good and does not do it, to him it's sin in his life." My precious mother called me 30 years ago, and she said, "Eugene, I fixed some things for the boys. Bring them over here so I can give them some candy and some goods." And I said, "No, ma'am, we will not." And she said, "But Eugene, you celebrated Halloween. And look at you, you turned out all right." And I said, "Yes, ma'am, but I read the book. I read the Bible, and I found out who knows what to do and doesn't do it is sin in his life. I also researched, and I found out that on Halloween, there's more children sacrificed to the devil than any other night in time. I researched and I found out just recently that 300 children are kidnapped a day in the DFW Metroplex." And I said, "No way, day. It's got to be a year." "No, day. So they can be sex trafficked." Is that the right word, trafficked? Sex trafficked. I asked you, January the 1st of this year, are you ready to receive all that God has for you? And you said yes. And I told you to hang on to your hats, because anything that could be shaken is going to be shaken out. I used to could grab the boys by their ankles and jerk them off the ground, and I could shake them real hard, and everything in their pockets begin to fly out. No telling what you'd find. Well, at times I felt like that God grabbed me by the ankles and he started shaking. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 18. I'll close with this one. I guess if I'd get the right one, I could read it. "O Corinthians, we have spoken openly to you," this verse 11, Our heart is wide open. You are now restricted by us, but you are restricted by your own affections. Now in return for the same, I speak as a children. You also be open. Do not be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness and lawlessness? And what communion has light with darkness? And what accord has Christ with Belial? Or what part has a believer with an unbeliever? And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God, as God has said. We cannot continue to mix light with darkness. Some of y'all may be upset. You may be shocked. Go and study it out yourself. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 34, on September 11th of 2011, on the 10th anniversary, I told God I would not leave my house until He gave me a word for the rest of my life. And the word He gave me was, my church is asleep. Wake my church up. And in 1 Corinthians 15, 34, it says, awaken to righteousness and do not sin. Bring the communion and stuff with you.
I know you didn't expect to walk into this, but I'm going to give you a reality of how the Lord really brought this home for me, and it's scriptural. I was reading in Revelations, and twice Jesus Himself said, the Nicolaitans you allowed to teach. The Nicolaitans, that thing I hate. Twice He says it. He addresses it, that thing I hate. And so I'm like, okay, Lord, who are the Nicolaitans? What did they do? How did they worship? So when I began to research and see the Word of God says, that's what kings do, is they search out a matter. And so I began to search it out. And then as in my research, I found the Evil Council of Nicaea, and I went, wait a minute, that's an abbreviation of Nicolaitans. So what they were doing was mixing paganism with the things of God. And in that Evil Council of Nicaea, when Constantine called this thing together with all these bishops, he said, we want nothing to do with those Jews and their holy feast days, because they were sun god worshipers, they were pagan worshipers, and that's a deep, dark, ugly rabbit hole. I fell on my face and I bawled, and I'll tell you exactly what I said. You son of a bitch, you son of Satan, there's where the world was bewitched, there's where we got bewitched. Yeah, I wept, and it broke my heart for every single one of us, because it has infiltrated our world, but God's setting us free from this. Now I'm going to give you another scripture in the Word where God's people were led unaware. They were tricked into sin. Balaam, who is a prophet of God, they were trying to hire him to curse the Israelites. God would not allow him to curse them, because God says, what I have blessed, you cannot curse. But what he did, he taught them how to trick them into sin with seduction of beautiful women. All this that we have fallen into in the church religious world has been a seduction that looks good, it looks fun.
And the thing that Balaam did, he taught them to marry the heathens that God said do not intermarry with. He said you're to wipe them out, you're not to intermarry with them. And he taught them how to get into sexual sin is basically what he did. And then they brought the curse upon themselves. Mm-hmm. And I want y'all to understand. Thank you.
Yeah. I just didn't want anyone to feel guilty at
no.
all.
And I want y'all to understand, I did not teach Sadie any of this. Mm-hmm. I've known this for the last 35 years. And I had to allow Sadie to come to a place that she searched it out herself. And I want y'all to understand, you've got to search this out yourself. You've got to understand. We celebrate a risen Savior 24/7, 365 days a year. You understand? It's every day of our lives we celebrate Jesus. He rose from the dead that we might have life and have it more abundantly. And so if you've got your bread and your juice, Jesus instituted the new covenant on Passover. And Passover was recognizing that God led Israel out of bondage in Egypt. Jesus symbolized it with the new covenant, the breaking of the bread and the juice, symbolizing that Jesus was that sacrificial lamb. He was putting the blood over each and every one of us that we might be forgiven. And so when we take the bread and we take the juice, we take the bread representing that physical body of Jesus. It came, was tempted in all areas, yet he knew no sin. We take this bread representing that physical body. Without the shedding of blood, there was no remission of sins. Without the blood over the doorpost in Egypt, there was no deliverance. And so the juice represents that blood that Jesus gave for us. And so we look to him that we are righteous, that we are free from guilt or sin, because he is our righteousness. And we receive that righteousness and that forgiveness of all of our sins through the blood of Jesus. Father, we thank you for this word. We thank you for this time. And I thank you, Father. The Sadie prayed at the very beginning. She had no idea what I was going to teach, but she prayed for the lucidity of your word to go forth. We see in your word that it was a celebration to celebrate Passover. We see that Jesus celebrated Passover, but we see a group of religious people wanting to do away with your word. And so, Father, we ask that you forgive us for our ignorance. You said in Hosea 4:6 that your people perish for a lack of knowledge. So, Father, I thank you for pouring your knowledge out upon us. In the same text, Father, you said that there is a spirit of harlotry that has entered the church of the living God. This is a part of that harlotry, Father. It's a part of what's going on in our nation right now, that the sexual perversion is so rampant and we didn't understand why. Why is it? Well, it's pretty obvious. If we'll call unto you, then you will answer. So, Father, we just bless you and we thank you for allowing us to be your sons and your daughters. We thank you that we are forgiven. And as we acknowledge this, Father, we ask you that you forgive us for just not searching a matter out. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks for watching this week's message. If you would like to partner with us financially or support our ministry, text the code KINGDOMLIFE to 94,000 or visit our website, cmjacksboro.com.